Sarve bhavantu sukhinah, sarve santu niramayah, sarve bhadrani pashyantu, ma kashchid dukha bhag bhavet. Om shantihi, shantihi, shantihi. Om Shanno Mitraha Sham Varunaha Shanno Bhavatvaryama Shanna Indro Brihaspatihi Shanno Vishnu Rurukramaha Namo Brahmane Namaste Vayu Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahmasi Tvameva pratyaksham brahma vadishyami, ritam vadishyami, satyam vadishyami, tanmam avatu, tadvaktaram avatu, avatu mam avatu vaktaram, om shantihi. Shantihi, Shantihi. Om Sahana Vavatu, Sahana Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavahi, Tejasvina Vadhitamastu, Ma Vidvishavahi. Om Shantihi, Shantihi, Shantihi. Om Yashchandasam Rishabho Vishwarupaha Chandobhyodhyamritat Sambabhuva Samindro Medhayas Prinotu Amritasya Devadharano Bhuyasam Shariram me Vicharshanam Jihva me Madhumattama Karnabhyam Bhuri Vishruvam Brahmanaha Koshosi Medhaya Pihitaha Shrutam me Gopaya Om Shantihi, Shantihi, Shantihi.
So first of all, as today, it is the first day of the traditional Indian calendar. So let me wish you a very joyful, peaceful, and blissful New Year. There are different ways of celebrating this occasion. In countries like Indonesia, especially Bali, it is celebrated in complete silence. The whole state shuts down television, electricity, radio, everything for 24 hours, no traffic, no shopping, no shops, nothing. It's called Nyepi, and it's a beautiful experience to be there, because they start celebrating it a few days earlier with all the purification rituals. Everybody goes to the ocean and carries their divinities to the ocean. The temples are purified. It is known as Malasti, the throwing away of the impurities, and then they have these carnival like how would you call it, like Julus
processions,
yes, in which they carry huge demonic figures, and then they are burnt, and then eventually comes the day of complete silence, where usually they even don't cook food at home, and this continues for 24 hours. The international airport, no flight comes, no flight goes, everything shuts down completely. In India, it is celebrated differently. This doesn't happen here in India. In India, it is celebrated more energetically. With the worship of the Divine Mother for 9 days. So from today onwards, the Divine Mother will be worshipped in her different manifestations for the 9 days. And so that is Shakti worship. The name of, because the Indian traditions give every year a name, and the name of this year, like the name of every year, is quite interesting. It is, it has a simple name, which means simple, Sadharana. That's the name of this new year, Sadharana, which means simple. It's not clear enough. Very low. What about now?
Yes.
Okay. It means simple, it means common. That is what it means in Hindi language. It is a widely used word. However, in its most ancient usage, it has been used in the Rig Veda as an equivalent term for Sama. Sama, which means sameness, equality. And I have repeatedly in my discourses pointed out that this Samatva, this sameness, even the Sanskrit word Sama is very similar to the English word same, is central to the idea of yoga. Shri Krishna goes as far in the Bhagavad Gita that he defines yoga as the path through which one cultivates equality towards all and towards all the circumstances in one's life. And this equality is a property that is fundamental to consciousness, to divinity, and to the manifested form of divinity, such as even the sun, which enlightens, gives life and light equally to all living entities. And it is in this context that the word sadharana has been used, when this sense of equality of the sun, or the sense of equality of that supreme principle, is celebrated in the hymns, in the praises of the Rig Veda, the most ancient collection of teachings of the masters from the Indian subcontinent. So the name is very beautiful. It brings us back to this idea of sameness, this idea of similarity, this idea of equality. So this was what I wanted to point out, just as today is the new year, so a little bit of information about that. One tradition which has always perplexed me, and I don't really find an answer from where this has come. Usually today, every household who would worship the Divine Mother for 9 days would do so by sowing a grain called jaw, yava. I don't know what it is called in English language. A grain. We call it jaw in Hindi and yava in Sanskrit.
It's either barley or millet.
Yeah, barley or millet, one of these, yes. Yeah, very small. It's, yeah. Millet is round, so then it's not millet. Because jaw is very similar to, yeah, then it's, yeah, then. No, it's not really wheat, it is jaw. In fact, Java has its name from this.
Really?
Yavadvipa, Java. It's Yavadvipa, sorry? Yeah. And then usually in 9 days, the sprout and the plant becomes this big, and that is then given as prasadam, as a blessing on the 9th day. And interestingly, this tradition seems to be an extremely ancient tradition, because what I've seen, Iranians, when they celebrate Nowruz, which is again their traditional new day of the year, they have the same practice, exactly the same practice. And I don't know from where this, most likely it is an extremely ancient, because both India and Iran both have their origins in the ancient Arya traditions, and most likely it predates both civilizations. Something else that I wanted to mention also occasionally. Yesterday after the class, I saw so many friends sitting in meditation after the class, which is really beautiful, because one can imbibe and assimilate better whatever we have practiced during the class. So it is a wonderful thing. One thing that in that regard I would just like to point out, and this is useful for everybody in all the circumstances, is that like when we sit on a brick in the beginning of the class during the prayer, why not do the same thing when we sit in meditation after the class? Brick might not be an ideal thing to sit upon in meditation, but something like a two-folded or three-folded blanket, such as I always use to sit, you know, can be used. And this is something that can be used at all times, whenever you need to sit on the ground, because it sort of gives a wonderful lift. The spine can be kept erect, straight, which is extremely important in meditation. Even in as simple as mindful breathing. And cushions don't really do, because cushions, sort of you sink into those cushions. They are too soft. So yes, people use meditation cushions, but with me that doesn't work. I really like something more hard, like a blanket. And this can be used unless we are sitting in Padmasana, where the extension comes naturally. I think this is an extremely useful thing, just to have a three-folded or two-folded blanket. In this way, if the knees are higher up, you don't collapse, and you don't, because if you collapse, then also the lumbar collapses. And from however untrained my eyes are in this context, I sort of had a feeling when I was looking at everybody sitting in meditation yesterday, they were a little bit collapsing. So some extension is required, and that is the use of carrying blankets. Carrying a blanket with oneself all the time was a very ancient practice. You see, Swargashram, the first ashram constructed in Rishikesh, was Baba Kali Kamli Wale Maharaj. His name, this was not his proper name, but he's famous with this name, which means the Baba with a black blanket. Baba Kali Kamli Wale. The Baba with a black blanket. And he was not the only one. There were several such Babas, such Swamis who were known. This one was Swami Atma Prakash Ji Maharaj. His original name was Swami Atma Prakash Ji Maharaj. Then the one in Kurukshetra is Swami Vishuddhanand Ji Maharaj. They were all known as Baba Kali Kamli Wale. And it's wonderful because you can use it as a yoga mat. You can use it as a meditation cushion. If you feel cold, you can wrap it around yourself. It can be used in all different ways. So that's all that I wanted to point out. Now coming back to the mantra that we were discussing, the section that we studied in our previous class was, may I be the carrier of the immortal wisdom. This is an extremely evolved, highly developed idea. What are the practical steps to that? And that is what I started pointing out in my previous session. Ashtanga Yoga, this whole path, the eight-limbed path, contains those practical steps of self-purification through which a person becomes the carrier, the bearer of that immortal essence. Recently, someone sent me a message, asked me that why is it that then teachers, yoga teachers in the West, emphatically say that yoga is not a purificatory practice? Has anybody of you heard something like this? Okay, then I just wanted to confirm that this is an individual observation, because I don't know what yoga teachers are teaching in the West, but this was one of the questions that I was asked by one of our viewers, so I wanted to see if anybody else agrees with that. That viewer said that my teachers have emphatically pointed out that yoga is not a purificatory practice. And I don't know why that emphasis, why not? I don't know, so I would like to understand what those teachers have in mind when they make such a statement. So I'm waiting for the answer of our viewer. Let's see what comes up. But Ashtanga Yoga, Patanjali himself clearly points out, Yoganga Manushtanat Ashuddhikshaye, when the Ashuddhis, when the impurities dwindle away through the practice of Yoganga, of the eight limbs of yoga. And within these eight limbs, tapas, which we translate as austerity. And when we hear the word austerity, we give it our own meaning. That's the problem. And it sort of starts to seem something like what we understand by self-denial, you know, or tormenting oneself. But I think the Indian spiritual traditions have always been, at least the yogic traditions, whether it is Vyasa's commentary where he defines tapas in the Yoga Sutras, whether it is the 17th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita where Krishna defines tapas and where he dismisses tapas in which one inflicts suffering on oneself, unnecessary suffering on oneself, which is what we think austerity, what we often equate austerity with, as demonic or tamasic in nature. The Buddha had the same approach, and that is why he preferred what he called the Madhyamaka path, the middle path, the Madhyama Marga, the balanced path. We find the same thing in yoga, we find the same thing in texts like the Bhagavad Gita, we find the same thing in the Upanishads. Tapasa anashakena, tapas that is non-destructive in nature. The adjective anashaka has been used, non-destructive in nature. But then what do we mean by tapas? Austerity, tapas on a physical level, on a verbal level, and on a mental level. The next three sentences of this mantra are about tapas on these three levels. First of all, on the physical level, on the level of the body. What does tapas mean on the level of the body? For example, Sri Krishna's detailed definition is to actively worship light and those who contain the light of wisdom within themselves. Deva dvija guru prajna pujanam shaucham, cleanliness, external and internal cleanliness, such as taking bath in the morning, external cleanliness, and then internal cleanliness as well, which comes through the practice of yoga. Honesty, straightforwardness, not trying to cheat others, arjavam, ahimsa, non-violence. These are the kinds of practices that Sri Krishna lists under sharira tapas, under physical tapas. What this sentence points out is the essential nature of physical tapas. Physical tapas is about having the body active. And this is what this next sentence, shariram me vicharshanam, me my sharira, sharira which means this body. The word, the Sanskrit word for the body is extremely beautiful. It constantly reminds us that this is temporal. This will be destroyed at some point, because Shri means to be destroyed. And Sharira is that which gets destroyed. And it does not only get destroyed at some point in the future, but the fact is that every moment of one's life, parts of this body are getting destroyed and are being replaced by new parts. And this happens in such a way that we don't even realize. So in fact, our body is nothing but like a flowing river in which the cells are like the drops of the water. Yes?
So the yoga tradition goes in the same principle like in the Buddhism, the kalapas, the passing of passing?
Sorry?
Kalapas,
yes. The yoga calls them tanmatras. Tanmatras. Yes. The yoga calls it the tanmatras, the five tanmatras, as from Sankhya calls it. So, sharira means that which will get destroyed and that which ultimately every moment of one's life. It is undergoing new creation, sustenance. Some particles, some parts of it are being created, some parts of it are being sustained, and some parts of it are in the process of death. In other words, the word sharira simply means the perishable aspect of our being. So shariram, and that is what I've translated with the word body, because it's in Hindi language also we use it for the physical body. So shariram me, but let that be very active. That is what the word vicharshana means, to be very active. Vicharshana also means capable to hold this wisdom within itself, capable to remain in its essential state, swastha, capable to remain in its essential state of be. Which means free from diseases, free from heaviness which leads to an inert state of the physical body. And that is indeed what the practice of asana does to us. It arogya, it leads to a state in which the body remains free from diseases, and it reduces also the rajas, which means hyperactivity, and tamas, which means inactivity. But it enables us to find the balance in between. So that is what asana practice does to us. Usually when we speak of austerity, and that is why I don't like that word, even though tapas is repeatedly translated as austerity, is because it has that idea of self-denial, self-infliction. And here in this case it means inflicting tremendous pain or suffering on one's body. On the contrary, in the yogic traditions, what we find is the idea that even though this body is temporary, it's not eternal, as a vessel of that consciousness, it has a nature of sanctity. Beautiful words are used. For example, the Upanishads use the word Brahmapura, the city of Brahman. Tadyadidamasmin Brahmapure. Look into this Brahmapura, the city of Brahman, in which there is this lotus-like heart. Search that which is within that. So the word Brahmapura has been used, the city of Brahman, the city of pure consciousness. The word Ayodhya, which today is the name of a city where Lord Rama was born. And there are two cities with this name. One is in India, which is the birthplace of Lord Rama, an extremely sacred city for Indians, and also the original capital of Thailand was also Ayodhya. Ayodhya. Again, because Thailand has a very similar culture to India. And yet, when we look at the teachings which Lord Rama too, after his birth, would have studied from masters like Vasishtha and Vishwamitra, in those teachings we find the same word, Ayodhya, the name of that sacred city, being used not for a city out there, for a particular city out there, but for this physical body, Ashtachakra, this city which has eight ramparts around it, which refers to the eight dhatus, skin, blood, flesh, fat, bone marrow, sinews, and semen, these eight dhatus of which the body contains. Ashtachakra, the city which has eight circles, Navadvara, and has nine doors, Devanam Pura Ayodhya. This is the city called Ayodhya, which is home to this luminous essence. So, Tasmin Yad Yaksha, that most venerable entity which resides within it, Tadvai Brahma Vidu Viduhu, the ones who know the teachings, they come to realize that. So the word Ayodhya has been used for this physical body. Kalidasa, the great poet of India, often compared as the Shakespeare of India, even though Shakespeare was in the 15th century, isn't it? And Kalidas was in the 5th century, so around 1,000 years before Shakespeare. He was born at least in Kalimat, near Guptakashi, which is just around 150 or 200 kilometers up here in the Himalayas. And he has written many beautiful plays and beautiful works of poetry. And in one of these, in the discussion between Shiva and Parvati, Shiva says, Sharira Madhyam Khalu Dharma Sadhanam, the first instrument to practice righteousness, to practice yoga, is your own body. That is the first instrument, that is the first tool. So that is the kind of sanctity that the body was granted. And Ayurveda too has to be seen in that context. Works on Ayurveda, such as Charaka Samhita, Sushruta Samhita, have chapters dedicated to yoga. The central idea of Ayurveda is to have a healthy body so that one can work to become aware of this essential essence within oneself, One of the Ayurveda sutras points it out very clearly. Anamayi, only when we are free from diseases, atmanam sammanyate, can we properly understand oneself. So this is the kind of ideas that we find in the Upanishads and in the teachings of the masters, and that is why the idea of inflicting unnecessary pain, of course, again, that is what we do in our yoga asana practice, but that is the kind of pain which is beneficial, which is uplifting, which leads to a sense of lightness, because we have worked hard for that. We have made our body extremely active. So, in other words, tapas on a physical level is about leading a healthy and a wholesome life which keeps us active. And that is why the masters, in practical terms, they have explained tapas in so many different ways, including taking in or eating only what is beneficial in limited amount and what is pure and clean. That too, for the yogic masters, is a form of tapas, is a form of austerity. So this first, this sentence, shariram me vicharshanam, may my physical body be active, be capable, be free from diseases, so that I can become the carrier of that immortal essence. This is the first physical tapas. Then comes tapas on the second level, tapas on the level of speech. Krishna, in the 17th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, explains tapas on the level of speech as mindful, to be mindful of what one speaks. We don't realize, but we speak sentences that cause agitation. Or we actually do it out of purpose because we want to create agitation. So what he says, anudvegakaram vakyam, sentences which don't cause agitation, which are not offensive in nature, priya, are pleasant to listen to, and are not only pleasant, you know, you are great, you are wonderful, not only that, but they should be beneficial for the person to listen to. Whatever we speak should be pleasant to listen to, but it's not such as these days we say, smearing honey on someone's mouth. Not that. Not vain talk. But something that is beneficial and truthful. Satyam, truthful. Priya, pleasant. Because again, the truth can at times be unpleasant. And by keeping ahimsa, non-violence, as at the center, as the central touchstone, if the truth leads towards violence, then the idea of the yogic masters is that such truth should be avoided. Unless, of course, it has to be spoken for the benefit of someone. But otherwise, the truth should be pleasant and should be beneficial. Satyam priyahitam chayat swadhyaya, and then studying about oneself. That is also because that is also something that we do with our speech. And the masters usually understand it as either to remain silent, or whenever one speaks, then one doesn't speak about unnecessary things, but one speaks about this essential nature of one's being. That is what Sri Krishna defines as vangmayam tapaha, as tapas on the level of speech. Krishna's definition is a little bit long. The sentence here is very simple. Jihva me madhumattama, which simply means, may my tongue be exceedingly sweet. Madhu means honey, sweet, and madhumattama means extremely sweet. Our jihva, our tongue, is an important tool for doing japa, for doing recitation, for discussing deeper ideas. The idea that the masters always had is that it should be kept clean. And the way to keep it clean is to speak a pleasant and beneficial truth, to stick with speaking with the pleasant and the beneficial truth. So on the face of it, this has a very simple meaning, just may my tongue be exceedingly sweet. However, the Sanskrit word madhu, which again is an extremely ancient word, we have it in English language also as mead, you know, mead, the liquor which is produced out of honey is known as mead. So it comes from that Proto-Indo-European root. In Sanskrit, that mead is called madhvi, produced from madhu. Madhvi is mead in Sanskrit, and madhu simply means honey. However, this word madhu does not only mean honey, but it also means wisdom. It also means knowledge. Very often in the Vedic teachings, fire, which symbolizes the fire of knowledge, is referred to as the honey-tongued one. And there the masters explain it that to have honey on one's tongue simply means to have this teaching, which lead one to that internal bliss, which is ultimately pointed out by that symbol honey. The teachings which lead us towards that internal blissful state, those two can be referred by the word madhu. And so to have those teachings on one's tongue, that is also what madhumattama, what containing honey on one's tongue is required, is meant for. And that is why this idea to have a honey, to have a tongue filled with honey is an idea which repeatedly occurs in the Vedic teachings again and again. Repeatedly, again and again. For example, elsewhere the masters say, Yadvadami madhumatvadami, whatever I speak, may I speak it only that which contains madhu in it, that which contains sweetness in it, sweetness in expression, as well as that sweet essential wisdom. That is what is meant. And that is why the kind of language that we find in the Upanishads, specifically where the dialogues take place between a husband and his wife, such as Maharshi Yajnavalkya and his wife Maitri, or father and son, or mother and son, these dialogues are extremely beautiful, and you can really feel the affectionate language. There's been so much emphasis being put on the language of the dialogue, which is extremely affectionate and loving in nature, which is extremely beautiful. Madhuman me nishkramanam, may my coming be filled with honey. Madhuman me parayanam. May my going away be filled with honey. Vacha vadami madhumat. May whatever I speak be contain honey. Madhu bhuyamsam madhusandrishaha. And whatever I may see, my vision may be filled with honey. This idea of honey is, one cannot speak enough about it. But again and again, also when we studied Ishavasya Upanishad, we discussed this, because the teacher of Ishavasya Upanishad is the one who has taught also Madhu Vidya, the wisdom of the honey, which again occurs in the Upanishads. So, jihva me madhumattama, may my tongue be exceedingly sweet, may my tongue contain honey within it. And then, now comes the third level, tapas on the mental level, which is about acquiring wisdom. Because mind is a tool to acquire knowledge, which then ultimately leads to wisdom. So mental tapas, tapas on the mental level, is understood as an effort that a person makes to acquire knowledge. And this is what we find being expressed in the next sentence, Karnabhyam Bhuri Vishruvam. May I hear abundantly with my ears. As I pointed out also in my previous class, that living wisdom, wisdom which is alive, is better to be received from someone who has lived it himself than it is alive. Then it, because whatever we read in books is something that has become old. Part of it might be extremely meaningful, but some parts of it might have fallen out of need, because we as an individual have evolved further. Our understanding has evolved further. These documents, such as the Ishava, such as the Upanishads, are still extremely useful today. And that is why we study them. Even though they are more than 3,000 years old, still the teachings that they contain are extremely meaningful. That is why we study. But not everything in them is meaningful. It was extremely meaningful for those people in those times. But today, we have moved ahead. Our times have changed radically within the last 100 years than humanity ever changed within the last thousands and thousands of years. So much has been changed. So if we just take a book of the Upanishads and start reading it, the language, the concepts, the ideas that we come across are extremely ancient. They have to be translated by someone of these times, and that is why my parents sent me to a teacher who himself received this wisdom from another teacher. And like this, in every tradition, a teacher learns it, practices it, renews the understanding of that wisdom, refreshes it, and then presents it in new light. But for that, reading is not enough. Reading a lot is not enough. What is required is listening a lot. And that is why I think this was the reason that up to the 10th century, most of the Vedic texts were never written down. They were always just, they lived in memory. The masters memorized it. The students had to memorize it. Then the meanings were conveyed to them. And that is how this wisdom traveled down. And it was only approximately in the 9th, 10th and 11th century that these works, these Vedic works, extremely ancient Vedic works, were then confined properly to writing. And that is why they are collectively referred to as Shruti. Shruti, which means the body of wisdom that one listens, that one listens to, that one hears. So, these three sentences, Shariram me vicharshanam, may my body be very active, Jihva me madhumattama, may my tongue be exceedingly sweet, and Karnabhyam bhuri vishruvam, may I hear abundantly with my ears. When I hear properly, attentively, then as I start assimilating it, questions come up. Then those questions start tormenting us. Then we go in search to find an answer. And this process of assimilation through questioning and finding an answer to one's questions is a natural process which follows when we hear something. When we listen to something, then after listening, Shravana, the next step is Manana. Manana, which means critical analysis. We critically, why did he say this? Does it really make sense? Does it make, logically, does it make sense? If it doesn't make sense to me logically, then why not? Why does not make sense logically to me? Then we come back with a question. Well, you said this, but it doesn't make sense logically to me. Why? Then the master tries to take apart the logical basis to the question and tries to find an answer to that question. But then ultimately, this is just a conceptual, intellectual understanding. Then we see, okay, but do I really feel like that? Do I really experience it? Yes, logically I've understood it. It's easiest to understand in our asanas, yes. Often when Mataji says, understood? Yes, we have understood it in our head. But then one has to do it. And then doing it actually, to fully bring it in one's experience, can take ages, can take a long time, because it requires a lot of practice. But that is the third step, nididhyasana. It's always listening, intellectual understanding, and then experience. These three steps. So when he speaks about hearing abundantly, he's not only speaking about hearing abundantly, but he's also, that shravana, that listening, includes, presupposes critical analysis of that which has been heard, and then the effort that one makes to experience that in one's life. So with this, these three sentences are over. Still one sentence in which Om has been declared to be the sheath of Brahman, to be the sheath of that consciousness. What does this sheath here mean? We'll come back to this idea in our next session. Still, if there are any questions or any yes.
Could you use the word moderation?
I think so, yes. Moderation would be a very good word, yes. To have a balance, whatever one has in one's life, to have it in a moderate, balanced amount. So not to harm oneself by going into the excess of something. So yes, moderation would be a good word for that. Yes. This is not jiva, this is jihva. Jihva, totally different word. This is a feminine word, and jiva is a masculine word.
It's a what?
Masculine word. Jiva is with a short A, and it does not have an H in it. This is Jihva. Jih, an H is there, and then Va is long. So it's a completely different word. Sorry?
And that's the only meaning.
Yes, that's the only meaning. Jihva, yes. It's the only. It's yes. The only meaning of that is tongue. Yes.
When you were saying about Matanjali, it's like the creation in the mind.
Sorry, can you say
if
that?
You were talking about Matanjali.
About?
Matanjali.
You mean Patanjali, sage
no,
Patanjali?
Matanjali. You don't say Matanjali?
Can someone help me with this? I must have used some word which she's trying to remember, but I can't remember which. Can you tell me a little bit more? Yes, please.
You were talking about the mind, the tapas in the mind, and I thought that you said Matanjali. So I was trying to understand that.
No, I can't remember now. If it occurs to me, I will let you know. No, because the only word that sounds similar to that is Patanjali. And I spoke about Patanjali. And Patanjali is the name of the author of the Yoga Sutras.
Yeah.
So, yes, yes.
I was following you until this word moderation as well. I understand that tapas has pitta. And I thought the tapas has something to do with fire. It seems like tells you when you use moderation.
Yeah. Yes, yes. She has an objection against this translation of tapas as moderation, because tapas contains that idea of fire to burn away one's impurities. But then you said, even if not to burn away oneself completely. So still moderation is there. Still some... Sorry?
I think that's the perfect point to burn yourself completely. Like, you say that that's not the point, that's the point.
Yes. Yes. If by the self we mean the ego, if by self, by the self we don't mean the body. Not to burn away the body like Sati did.
Just in connection with this, translating tapas as moderation is a very, very specific move that only works for certain sections of Indian religion.
Yes.
If you look at Jainism, for example, they have this institution of ritual suicide by hunger. So
yes.
You don't eat until you die. That's also tapas.
For the,
yes. If anyone wants to try it, then go for it. But it's difficult. And this is what Krishna was talking about.
But again, regarding Santara, I must say that the way I understand it is a very natural process. When a person becomes very old, is incapable of eating and drinking anything, at that moment, it doesn't make sense to forcefully feed that person. And so they go into this Santara. Usually the individuals that go into Santara are individuals that are at the very last stage. And this is considered a form of tapas in Jainism. So what he's speaking about is Jainism, is specific to Jainism. There used to be something similar in Hinduism also, known as prayopavesha, such as Parikshita did, but he knew that I'm going to die after 7 days.
Now Navratri so, is beginning, all the housewives will be doing tapas.
They will be doing tapas, yes. They will be... No, they are not going to die. They are just fasting, which is...
In which chapter Krishna talks about the speech?
17th chapter. 17th chapter is all about sattvika tapas, rajasika tapas, tamasika tapas.
Krishna is saying that your limited self is not different from me. So if you are going to burn yourself and hurt yourself just to get to me, you will be hurting me as well.
Yes, that's what he says. That's what he points out to us. So you're hurting, in fact, me in the process if you're hurting yourself. Yes. No. It's written very, very differently. Shri is a root, and the root of Shri as the title is the same root which we have in Hindi words like ashraya, to support, and that is why the word Shri in the title is in fact the word for wealth, because wealth supports us, sustain us. So that in the title, that is derived from the root Shri, which means it is written differently. The spelling is very different, and it sounds similar, but the spelling is different, and it means to support. And the root Shri in Sharira means to get destroyed. So the root is different, the meaning is very different. Hope that makes it clear. Yes. Anybody? Okay. Still, sometimes we have questions that we don't want to ask in front of everyone, so please, I will be here. Let me know if you have any such questions. Let us conclude with the prayer for universal well-being. Sarve bhavantu sukhinah, sarve santu niramayah, sarve bhadrani pashyantu, ma kaschid dukha bhag bhavet. Om shantihi, shantihi, shantihi. My humble salutations to you. Thank you very much.